The 2023 United Nations Conference on Climate Change, known as COP28, will start in Dubai on November 30th. After a year of extreme weather events, it'll be a chance for the countries to come together to discuss what can be done next. But what about the situation of Bangladesh? What can this country, one of the most vulnerable to the effects of climate change, do? And what can it get from this conference? To discuss this issue, we're joined by Dr. Patrick Verkooijen of the Global Center on Adaptation, who is working with the government of Bangladesh to find climate solutions on adaptation that can be implemented at scale and with speed. Professor Patrick, welcome back to Inside Out.
Thank you so much, Shomek.
So, do you expect any good news for Bangladesh in COP28?
Well, good news or bad news, I'm not sure about that with these international processes. Why? Because there is quite something happening at the international arena. There's a Ukraine war, there's an Israel invasion into Palestine, there's a debt crisis, a food security crisis, an energy crisis. So there are lots of competing agenda items asking for world leaders' attention. And climate change, I mean, comes on top of that. That the climate emergency is even further intensifying. You can also see it here clearly in Bangladesh. There is a vast need of financial investments into climate mitigation, but also in adaptation. So what is on the agenda at COP28, this climate summit towards the end of the year, is de facto the world will do a couple of things. One, it will do a stock take. In 2015, the Paris Agreement came into force. Nations came forward with their climate plans. How much are they on track to deliver on these plans? And the reality is they're vastly off track. Basically making that clear in COP28 obviously is not enough. Determining that the world is off track to deliver on its 1.5 degree target needs more increased ambition of all nations, but particularly from the rich countries. So that is basically a very important agenda item. The second agenda item, which the Prime Minister, the Honorable Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, has been advocating for a long time, is on loss and damage. At the moment, the international community is already experiencing loss and damage from climate impacts, particularly here in Bangladesh, but also in Africa and other places. Someone has to compensate for these losses. So that's a very important agenda item as well. And the third agenda item for COP28, the climate summit at the end of the year, is on adaptation finance. We know, of course, that we have to lower our carbon footprint, but at the same time, we have to adapt our food systems, our infrastructure systems, to the adverse effects of climate change. But someone needs to pay for it. Put it into context. Bangladesh itself is paying out of its own public resources, so the taxpayers from Bangladesh, $2 billion a year on climate adaptation. That's a lot of money. But how much should be invested in Bangladesh in climate adaptation is $8 billion a year. So there's a vast gap of adaptation finance to be filled. 2 years ago, the international community promised to deliver, to double on adaptation finance. Now at COP28, the world has to deliver on its implementation. So it's all to play for. And that's why I was delighted to hear earlier today that the Honorable Prime Minister is going to COP28, making a strong plea on behalf of the Global South for this very important adaptation agenda indeed.
Let's take a short break and we'll be right back with more Inside Out. We're back with Dr. Patrick Verkooijen on Inside Out. So last time we spoke, you discussed a kind of climate apartheid regime that had been established across the globe. So in securing the funds, these funds or other major climate objectives, what is Bangladesh preparing to do and what can they realistically do?
So Bangladesh is one of these front runners countries as it comes to adaptation. Why is that? Because first, they have a national plan, right? They have a Delta Plan 2100, they have a Mujib Climate Prosperity Plan. So they have the framework in place in identifying the priority areas for investment. Secondly, they have identified already their own public resources to match to these national projects. Thirdly, what is quite promising is that the international finance institutions here, based here in Bangladesh, the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, the IMF, all came forward with very strong project finance commitments towards the national planning of Bangladesh. What we as a Global Center on Adaptation, what we do, what we bring to the table is unique adaptation expertise sourced from the global community, which we put on the table to influence and shape the projects of the Asian Development Bank, whether it's coastal restoration, whether it's on secondary city urban planning, such as in Bangla. I think it's very important that the infrastructure of today, the realization that not all of it is climate-proofed, but that we need to make sure that the infrastructure being invested in the coming period has sort of the climate risks mainstreamed into its design and its implementation. So I think Bangladesh has the ideas. It has the political leadership to drive this agenda. Now it's up to the international community to match the aspirations and the financial commitments of the Bangladesh people. And I think that is the journey ahead of us. We're running out of time. We have an abundance of challenges, but quite frankly, a scarcity of time to deliver them.
So speaking on this conference, there has been some criticism of the fact that it's being held in Dubai. UAE is a OPEC member and a major oil-producing country. Do you see any tension here?
Well, first and foremost, I mean, these COP presidencies, because it's hosted by a country, and that country then is the COP president, is supposed to be a neutral broker in terms of getting the outcomes out of a COP process, one. Secondly, the oil and gas industry has to be part of the solution. There is no way to a 1.5 degree world without robust commitments from the oil and gas industry to clean up their own act. So in that sense, we can also, I'm inclined to go along with John Kerry, presidential envoy of the United States, to say, well, it is up to the COP president, Sultan Al-Jaber, who is from the oil and gas industry, who is, by the way, a leader on the renewable energy side, to bring the oil and gas industry to the table. But they have to deserve that seat at the table to clean up their own industry. And that is a very important deliverable also for COP28. So let's plan for an inclusive process, but we also be very clear who should deliver what, by when, and in what fashion. Oil and gas industry has to come to the table with strong commitments, whether it's on methane emissions, whether it's transitioning to renewable energy. I think whether it's to mainstreaming a carbon neutral footprint into our own operations, lots of good ideas are currently being discussed. 6 weeks from now, we will know whether the oil and gas industry is serious or not.
Let's take a short break and we'll be right back with more Inside Out. So you corrected me earlier saying that this is your 10th visit to Dhaka.
Indeed.
So what is on your agenda this time?
So why am I here on my 10th visit is also the recognition that there's lots to learn from Bangladesh itself. It's not that the global north comes to Bangladesh, shares expertise, and that basically Bangladesh are just the victims of this debate. No, lots of deep expertise, practical solutions, financial engineering is taking place in Bangladesh. Why am I here today is basically recognize that sort of deep expertise and have this two-way street. On the one hand, what we as Global Center on Adaptation, what we do, we unlock the great experience, particularly on locally led adaptation, basically giving voice to the voiceless here in Bangladesh and sharing that expertise with other parts of the world, such as in Africa, whether it's in Kenya, whether it's in Senegal, or in Ghana. So that's one part of my agenda. And the second part is this. Asian Development Bank, World Bank, and International Monetary Fund, they have very important programs here upstream to be implemented in the coming periods. What we have offered to these international finance institutions in strong partnership with the United Kingdom, with Canada, with the Bangladesh government, to form a partnership to make sure that every development project in Bangladesh is climate resilient. I think that is the clear vision of the government, of the Prime Minister herself. And we as international community are sharing not only the financing, but also the expertise and putting it on the table. The third reason why I'm here is that the Honourable Prime Minister has kindly offered to host the largest nature-based solutions office here in Bangladesh for South Asia of the Global Centre on Adaptation. We currently already are established here in Bangladesh, of course, but we will, in the beginning of next year, after the elections, we will build what we currently also have in the Netherlands, is the largest voting office in the world. We will build an iconic, not just a center, but a solution space where all partners can come together, share best practices, and deliver on the ground. And I think that is a very exciting sort of iconic materialization of the journey which we are here see and unfold here in Bangladesh.
So since the last time we spoke, what have been the major developments in the fields of climate change and climate adaptation?
Well, the major development is that every day which passes, the climate emergency is spinning further out of control. Now, on top of that, we have an El Nino phenomenon basically already tipping the world over the 1.5 degree world. So we now are sort of on the precipice where we see that we basically, Antonio Guterres, Secretary General of the United Nations, he called it, we're now in uncharted territory. Basically, compared to my last visit, we have less time to invest in climate adaptation. Adaptation investments are unfolding, but again, they're not happening at the scale and speed required. That's precisely what we need to do in Bangladesh and other countries similar to Bangladesh indeed.
So we've been speaking about climate diplomacy being one path to adaptation. What do you think Bangladesh can do to improve its stance on climate diplomacy specifically?
So what is a very important realization? There is not a development trajectory on the one hand and a climate agenda on the other hand. Climate smart, climate resilient development goes hand in hand. It is investing in roads, in bridges, in housing and other infrastructure services, which has to be climate resilient. So I think the approach which the government is taking here to basically say all development, all resources, all investments have to be green and clean, that's quite frankly quite a bold a move, but it's exactly the right move for a country like Bangladesh and other countries. Why? Because investing in climate adaptations is not just good for the climate. It's good for the economy, it's good for our health, there is a triple dividend, and there's lots of money to be made here. So thank you very much.
Dr. Patrick, thank you for your time.
My pleasure.
And thank you all for watching. We'll be back next week with another episode of Inside Out.